It's past 9:30 a.m. in the Iranian capital, Tehran. You're watching Press TV's World News. Now, top story, Tehran has blasted anti-Iran provisions of the U.S. National Defense Authorization Act signed into law by President Joe Biden. Foreign Ministry spokesman Nasser Kanani said the provisions reflect the continuation of Washington's hostile, provocative, and meddlesome policies against Iran. Kanani said they are also aimed at stoking Iranophobia and promoting a propaganda campaign against the Islamic Republic. He pointed to Washington's false allegations against Tehran's peaceful nuclear program specified in the Defense Authorization Act. Kanani said it was the U.S. that violated the international law by pulling out of the 2015 nuclear deal, adding the accusations will not legitimize Washington's illegal sanctions against Tehran. The National Defense Authorization Act, signed into law last week, accuses Iran of lack of transparency with the International Atomic Energy Agency and vows to combat what it describes as Iran's aggression. Joining us is Alexander Azadgan. He is a academic and political analyst from Irvine, California. Professor Azadgan, welcome. What's your take on this? Let's debunk the fake news. Is there a country in the world with more rigorous inspections by the International Atomic Energy Agency than Iran, despite its peaceful nuclear program, according to the U.S. intelligence community? And the IAEA has never visited Israel's Dimona, for example, and this is the regime that does have nuclear weapons.
Good to be with you, Wassam, and our global audience. Just picking up by the last thing that you said, now we have Netanyahu back at the premiership, prime ministerial position in Israel, and this is not going to be constructive. His administration consists of the most radical right-wing, crazy religious factions. So the hypocrisy, of course, as we have been saying for decades, is unfathomable. But going back to our story, with Trump's reneging and withdrawal from the JCPOA in 2018, the Iranian nuclear deal, for all means and purposes, is dead, null and void. What we have been seeing since then are ongoing numerous gridlock and accusations. Now I want to focus now on the U.S. National Authorization Act. Today the House passed for the 62nd consecutive year the final agreed upon text of the fiscal year 2023 NDAA, National Defense Authorization Act, and it sent it to the Senate for the final vote, which obviously is going to be approved. NDAA accused Iran of lack of transparency with the IAEA. This is completely false.
Let's return to our earlier story regarding Tehran that has blasted the anti-Iran provisions in the U.S. National Defense Authorization Act that has been signed into law by President Joe Biden. Our guest is Alexander Azadgan, academic and political analyst from Irvine. Alexander, we were trying to debunk the fake news. Is there a country, I was asking, in the world with a more rigorous inspections program by the International Atomic Energy Agency than Iran, despite we hear from the U.S., according to the U.S. intelligence community, that it is a peaceful nuclear program? And this is while the IAEA has never visited Israel's Dimona, for example. And that this is the regime that does have nuclear weapons.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned when we get to the crux of the matter, somehow in a very bizarre manner, I get disconnected. This has happened several times when I'm with Press TV, and I, of course, we know who does that from this end. Like I was saying, the NDAA accused Iran of the lack of transparency with the IAEA. This is completely false. Up until 2018 and a little further than that, IAEA itself admitted over 10 consecutive visits of Iran's nuclear site, minus Fordo, and verified Iran's full compliance. Of course, things have changed during the past couple of years, but it was Trump who kickstarted and even further created a spirit of distrust. This is a fact, not conjecture. But what exactly, our audience may be interested to know, what exactly is the NDAA? What does it consist of? Section 1245 of the NDAA requires the president to block the property and interest subject to U.S. jurisdiction of all financial institutions of Iran, including the CBI, Central Bank of Iran. It also aims to reduce the Iranian oil revenues and discourage transactions with the CBI by providing sanctions on all foreign financial institutions that knowingly conduct or facilitate certain significant financial transactions with CBI. And going from that to the next point I'm going to make, the political atmosphere between Iran and US is completely toxic now. When Biden tries to bargain, this is really interesting, our audience may want to pay close attention to this point. When Biden tries to bargain over Iran's recent unrest and anarchies in the streets of Tehran, it's clear to everyone that the level of hegemonic arm twisting has reached even a new level by Washington's standard. By that, I'm referring to the Biden administration actually having the audacity to state that they have the willingness to end its support for the anti-Iran protests in the streets of Tehran, and also stop selling, if Iran stop selling drones to Russia, and, which is the subject of our interview today, and make concessions on its nuclear program. This, when I heard this a few days ago, I was absolutely outraged. He's actually admitting to supporting and creating unrest in the streets of Tehran and other places in exchange for making concessions with Iran. I honestly don't know where international lawyers are, international law, where exactly these people are and what they're talking about and how come they're silent on this. We all know that they are trying to push and rule-based international law, which is a sham, because guess what? Five or six countries get to make the rules, but international law is absent in condemning all this. And now with Netanyahu coming to power again, with the most radical, religious, crazy fundamentalist on his side, things are going to get even more complicated when it comes to what's left of the JCPOA, which is really not much. It's just face-saving and keeping up the appearances. Yeah.
We've also heard from Iranian officials that during their bilateral meetings with foreign European and American, not European leaders, that they've admitted also that they can withdraw support for the riots in return for some concessions from Iran. So it's a very important point that you raise, Alexander. And also in the NDAA, it speaks about Iran's aggression. This is the country that wiped out terrorism from the region, preventing terrorists from staging terror attacks, not just in West Asia, but in Europe, for example, which they did. On the other hand, if it wasn't for the late Lieutenant General Qasem Soleimani, terrorists will still be killing Europeans on European soil. On the other hand, we see the US military presence with its hundreds of military bases in West Asia bringing nothing but instability and insecurity and aggression, as the NDAA puts it.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, Washington has resorted to the lowest of tactics. It has no tools but to export chaos and anarchy everywhere, whether it's political or geopolitical. Look at what they were trying to create between China and Taiwan with Nancy Pelosi's visit there, which had all of us baffled, because according to them, Biden discouraged her, but she went anyway. It seems to me anywhere Washington goes, whether it's Afghanistan or Libya or Iraq, Yemen, where they're supporting the GCC, Gulf Cooperation Council countries headed by Saudi Arabia, they export nothing but mental institutions or graveyards for the countries that they'll go into. And there is a very shameful silence on behalf of the international community when it comes to Iran affairs. Now, things have drastically changed from 2015 when JCPOA was signed. We have this unrelenting war between Russia and Ukraine. This has changed the ball game quite differently. But when it comes to superpowers, all superpowers, what they do when they don't get what they want, they just keep changing the goalposts and completely changing the standards and rules as they go by. Why would any country want to get into an international accord or any political arrangement with a so-called partner that keeps breaking its word at every step, even when it's negotiating? So JCPOA is dead. Iran is only there to prove that it's still in there. But without the U.S., nothing's gonna pass. Even with Russia's situation changing, even with China-Taiwan relationship changing, I don't see anything. I would advise the Iranians that I don't see anything positive coming out of what's left of this international nuclear accord.